Well, I should say briefly, the new record is, it's my first record of cover songs, and it's based on a list of 100 essential songs that my father gave me when I was 18 years old. And I had the good sense to save this list for a few years.
For those of you that may have been born under a rock, Rosanne's father was Johnny Cash.
He had a good sense of songs.
And only one of two people who's been inducted both into the Country Music Hall of Fame and the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
And an interesting musical figure for a number of reasons, but to me, he was one of the originators of rock and roll with the Sun Records label in Memphis, but also a custodian and guardian of America's great heritage of folk songs and indigenous songs.
Right. He did have a musicologist's understanding of American roots music, and particularly the evolution of Southern music and country music and folk, blues, protest songs, Southern gospel. All of that played very heavily into his musical consciousness. So that list that he gave me comprised 100 of those songs. What did you want me to do first?
What about the Carter?
Oh, something from the list.
Yeah,
right.
The two songs.
This is probably the newest song on the list. It's a Bob Dylan song.
Well, if you're traveling in the North Country Fair, wind hit heavy on the borderline. Remember me to one who lives there. She once was a true love. If you go when the snowflakes storm, the rivers freeze and summer ends, please see she has a coat so warm. Keep her from the howling winds. Oh, I'm wondering if she remembers me at all. Many times I've often prayed in the darkness of my night. In the brightness of my day. If you're traveling in the North Country Fair,
Thank you. Thank you.
You had this list of 100 essential songs, which were your education.
Yes.
You had already been to Vanderbilt. You had gone to college, right?
But I didn't graduate.
But I'm actually an MIT dropout myself.
It's good to know. Gives me hope.
Your father and you were on the tour bus, and he was astonished at your, you know, you grew up in Southern California. And
yeah. I grew up in Southern California listening to the Beatles, to Buffalo Springfield, to Neil Young, Janis Joplin, Joni Mitchell, which was the first time I realized a woman could be a songwriter, actually, when I got Blue. And of course I knew country music, you know, my father and people he would drag home off the road. And my mother listened to Patsy Cline and Marty Robbins. So all of that kind of went in by osmosis. But what I chose to listen to, like any adolescent and pre-adolescent, you choose your own music. You go away from what your parents listen to. So when I went on the road with him after high school, he was alarmed at the lack of depth of my knowledge of not only country music, but roots music. So he spent the afternoon making this list for me. And it was an education. I mean, the most beautiful part of him making that list is that he was giving me himself. You know, this made up his musical DNA. He was saying, this is who I am. And really, this is who you are too, which I found out later.
So of the 100 songs, how did you choose, or why did you choose this one to be among the ones you'd record first?
Well, I wanted to balance the record. There had to be a Carter Family song, an Appalachian song. There had to be, Jimmy Rogers had to be represented. Those corners were taken. There had to be Southern Gospel. Long Black Veil, which is the quintessential country song, had to be on the record. There is no country music without the song Long Black Veil. And
so a very scholarly approach.
Very scholarly approach, actually, yes. Yeah. No, seriously. Yeah. And so the newest song is...
You see why she's the perfect person to be here.
The newest song is Girl from the North Country.
Yeah.
And I realized later that it had only been 4 years since my father had recorded it with Bob Dylan on Dylan's Nashville Skyline, which is why in 1973 it was still in his mind, this is a great song. This is a classic American song. Dylan actually wrote it in 63. When we went to record Girl from the North Country, I felt so intimidated and felt like this was one of those iconic pieces of music that I could not approach. And because I had images of my dad and Bob doing it, you know, I was 14 years old. I remember it very clearly and how important Nashville Skyline was. And so John Leventhal, who's my husband who produced this record and wrote all the arrangements, he said, we have to go back to the 63 version and listen to Bob's original version, which is a great classic folk ballad, and approach it that way, which is what we did.
You know, as somebody who spends a lot of his time working in a laboratory, when I hear Rosanne talk about how she selects songs and then how she develops them, it's really not that different than what scientists do in a research laboratory. I mean, it's an experiment, right?
Right.
Bob's first version of the song you could think of as an experiment. I'm gonna try this and see if it works and if it fits. And if I'm not happy with it, I'll tinker with it and I'll refine it a few years later. And you probably went through several versions of it yourself.
Right, I'd have a little bit different take on it in saying that both versions worked equally well. They're just different interpretations. In my opinion, a great song deserves a lot of interpretations. And that's what gave me license to approach some of these songs that were really iconic. Like I said, you know, Patsy Cline's vocal on She's Got You is just seared into my head from childhood, so that one was a little hard to get off my shoulder. But in thinking about it, that these songs deserve to stay alive, you shouldn't just have to visit them in a museum or go back to the 1954 recording. They should stay alive.